আসসালামু আলাইকুম। স্টার্ট করব।
জি ম্যাডাম, শুভম।
Honorable Chairperson of today's session, Independence Awardee, Legendary Professor, Brigadier General Noor Fatema Madam, Head of the Pediatrics and Pediatric Cardiology of CNH Dhaka, Chief Pediatric Cardiologist of Lab 8 Cardiac Hospital Dhaka, and Chairman Congenital Heart Disease Foundation Bangladesh. Respected panelists, Professor Abiyam Abdus Salam, Senior Consultant, Star Hospital Dhaka, and ex-HOD of Pediatric Cardiology Department of NICVD. Distinguished guest and participant from home and abroad, assalamu alaikum and very good afternoon to all. This is Dr. Nazneen Umme Jakia, Associate Professor of Pediatric Cardiology, NICVD. Would like to welcome you all to today's Friday session of virtual class. It's a continuation of a series of lectures, and today is the 17th day, organized by the Congenital Heart Disease Foundation, Bangladesh, with joint collaboration of Narayana Health and Vaccine Performer Limited. It's a great honor for me to present here as a moderator, and I'd like to express my gratitude and heartfelt thanks to ma'am. Our today's topic is top management issues, and our speaker is Professor A.K. Shamsuddin. And before starting, I would like to introduce him. Professor A.K. Shamsuddin graduated from Sir Salim Ullah Medical College in the year 1994. He completed his MS in cardiovascular and thoracic surgery from NICVD in the year 2003 under Dhaka University. And he did his fellowship training in pediatric cardiac surgery from Spot Delhi in the year 2008 to 2009. At present, he is working as a professor and senior consultant of Department of Pediatric Cardiac Surgery in National Heart Foundation Hospital and Research Institute. Now, I would like to request Dr. A.K. Shamsuddin to deliver his lecture. Dr. A.K. Shamsuddin, please.
Shamsuddin can share a slide. Dr. Shamsuddin, you please share your slide.
Yeah, one second.
Unmute, please.
Am I audible?
The sound is not so clear.
No? Am I audible now?
Yes.
See my slides? Can you see my slides?
Yes. You can see your slide.
Yes.
Respected chairperson, learned panelist, and respected audience, assalamu alaikum. Today, I am going to present the surgical treatment of the tetralogy of fellow. Now, in 1944, first surgical treatment, that is the palliative treatment of the tetralogy, started. She is the Helen Tosic, she is the pediatric cardiologist, and she actually got the patients of tetralogy of fellow, and she was helpless because almost all the patient dies due to spell attack or after few period of time after birth. Then he insisted the then surgeon Alfred Bellow to do something for these blue babies. And the Alfred Bellow with his lab technician Vivian Thomas, they started working on it, and they ultimately in 1944 they successfully did the first systemic pulmonary shunt. And actually, Thomas was the lab technician. He was the main person who actually designed the shunt. And the history of corrective surgery started after 10 years in 1954. He first did the successful circulation. Mother was acted as a pump oxygenator. And in 1955, first successful repair of the tetralogy with a pump oxygenator was done by Kirklin and et al. This is the Walton de Lehi. This is the design of the control cross circulation. And this is the operation where the baby was operating and the mother was on the side table and used as a pump oxygenator. Now come to the main point, that is morphology of the tetralogy of the fellow. Though it's the tetralogy, that means four component, but basic problem is one, that is the anterior and cephalic deviation of the conal septum. It is overriding of the aorta and pulmonary stenosis. As a result of stenosis, there will be hypertrophy of the right ventricle. This is the external morphology after opening of the chest. Before taking decision for surgical correction, a meticulous evaluation is needed. And a good cardiologist can give all the information by doing echocardiography. We have to know the level of the pulmonary stenosis. It may be the valvular, subvalvular, supravalvular, or combination of all combinations. We have to know the size of the pulmonary annulus. If it is very small, then may we have to put the transannular patch and also have to know the RPA and LPA size at the level of the hilum. It is required for the to see the adequacy of the total correction or not. And we have to know the good cardiologist can miss the additional VHD because of the high right ventricular pressure. So the surgeon after closing the VHD should check for additional VHD. And have to assess the right ventricular function. Left ventricular function also should not ignore because few patients may have left ventricular dysfunction due to deleterious effects of hypoxia. It may cause fibrosis of the left ventricle and hence the left ventricular dysfunction. And also we have to know the overriding of the aorta. We have to know in details about the coronary anatomy, whether there is any anomalous coronary is crossing the right ventricular outflow tract or not. We should know before we have to put the transannular patch, we have to modify the techniques. Otherwise, we may cut the LAD crossing the RVOT. And we have to check whether there is any PDA, proximal MAP curves, or any previous shunt. Cardiologists can give all this information by doing echo. Even then, we are comfortable if we can go for CT scan before operation because it gives some additional information. It gives a clear idea about the distal arborization of the pulmonary arteries. And also, we can get information about the origin and course of the MAP curves. See here the clearly delineation of the large MAP curves, which may have to fix preoperatively during operation or after operation. After getting all this information, we have to assess the suitability of total correction. There are some parameters which gives us idea about the suitability of total correction. One is the MAC-Boone ratio, that is the diameter of the right pulmonary and diameter of the left pulmonary artery divided by diameter of the descending thoracic aorta at the level of the diaphragm. And this MAC-Boone ratio should be more than 0.8 for total correction. And Nakata index is the cross-sectional area of the right pulmonary and left pulmonary artery in per square meter of the body surface area. and it should be more than 150 millimeter square per meter square of the body surface area. And mitral and tricuspid valve ratio, it indicates the adequacy of the left ventricle. If we know that in tetralogy of Fallot, LV is relatively small, but if it is too small, it cannot withstand correction. The ratio should be more than 0.65. It indicates that LV is adequate. And Z score of the branch pulmonary arteries, it should be more than, Z score should be more than minus 0.2 for total correction. If the, all the criteria do not match with the, do not fulfill all these criteria, then we have to go for palliative treatment. Or the patient is very much symptomatic, having repeated his spell attack and have comorbid condition, then also we have to go for palliative correction. And two types of palliative correction, one is the systemic to pulmonary artery shunt and another is the palliative transannular patch. Among the systemic to pulmonary artery shunt, mostly done is the blalactosic shunt. Others are port shunt, water stone shunt, and central shunt. This diagram shows the various types of the shunt. The right hand side is the classical BT shunt, where the subclavian artery is divided, distally ligated, and the proximal part anastomosed with the pulmonary artery. Disadvantage of this shunt is that there may be the underdevelopment of the corresponding limb. So it is rarely done nowadays, but there is a huge advantage because it, as it is a natural, there is a less need of the antiplatelet drugs after the operation. And it usually do not get blocked. So it lasts many years. But as there is a chance of limb ischemia and underdevelopment of the lung, limb, there is a, nowadays, very few surgeons does this classical BT shunt. And in modified BT shunt, a synthetic graft of adequate size is placed between the subclavian artery and the pulmonary artery. And advantage is that there is a less chance of limb ischemia and underdevelopment of the limb. But the disadvantage is that till next operation, patient has to take the antiplatelet drugs. Patient have to keep the hydrated well. Otherwise, the shunt may get blocked if the patient even develop hypotension or hypercoagulable state of the blood. So if the patient suffers from any diarrhea or high fever, patient's parents should give adequate fluid to keep it well hydrated, otherwise the shunt may get blocked. And another advantage can be done in any side of the arch. In classical BT shunt, it has to be done opposite the arch, otherwise it will get kinked. But modified BT shunt can be done in any side, and it can be done by lateral thoracotomy or can be done in the midline thoracotomy. Water stone shunt is the shunt between the ascending aorta and the right pulmonary artery, and port shunt is between the descending aorta and the left pulmonary artery. These shunts are very rarely done nowadays because of the very early development of the pulmonary vascular resistance. And another palliative treatment is the palliative transannular patch. If the pulmonary artery is small, then have to put a narrow transannular patch, then the both the pulmonary artery will get supply from the RV and it will grow, and once it grows, then we can go for total correction. Advantage is that it both the pulmonary artery gets equal supply, and there is a chance of equal growth of the both the pulmonary arteries, and there is a less chance of distortion of the pulmonary arteries, which may happen rarely in case of BT shunt. Now we'll go for discuss about the total correction. And total correction is always RDAs. And because
There are lots of advantages. We can do total correction in very early age. Because it ameliorates the deleterious effects of the hypoxia, it prevents the persistent myocardial hypertrophy, and decreases the hematological changes, that is the polycythemia and platelet dysfunction, and reduces the incidence of defective endocarditis and cerebral abscess. Now the question is how are you?
Please mute yourself. Other than Dr. Shamsuddin, please mute yourself, everyone.
How early actually it depends on the institutional support system. If the pediatric cardiac surgery unit can handle the baby in a very early stage, that is the neonatal stage, some of the centers who are, they are doing in the neonatal period with a very good results. But the disadvantage of doing corrective surgery in the neonatal period is that there is an increased chance of capillary leakage, there is a more need for peritoneal dialysis, and as the immune system do not grow well at that age, so there is a chance of infection is also high. But if the patient centers who are capable of dealing with all these things, they are doing the total correction in the neonatal period with a good results. In our National Heart Foundation, we are not doing in the that much early period of time, but we are doing as early as around 6 months of age with a reasonably good results. Now, what are the components of the corrective treatment? With the VHD, obviously we have to close the VHD, and VHD can be closed transatrially or through the right ventricle. And it actually depends on the site of the VHD. Most of the VHD is subarterial, and it can easily close transatrially. And few VHDs are doubly commutated or subpulmonary, and this can be better closed through the right ventricular outflow tract. This is the operative order. This is the dectrone patch closure of the VHD through the right atrium. And this cartoon shows. And the next is they have to relieve the pulmonary stenosis. It depends on whether the pulmonary stenosis is there. If it is the right ventricular muscle band, then only we have to resect the muscle band. We usually incise the muscle band through the right atrium and then through the tricuspid valve. This cartoon shows this resection of the septoparietal bands. And after resection of the bands through the right atrium, we used to open the right ventricle vertically, because there may be some excessive muscles which may not be approachable to the right atrium. Then we have to excise that additional muscle bands, and then we have to put a transannular patch. And before putting the only patch in the right ventricular outflow tract, before putting the patch, we negotiated the adequate size of the Haggart's. If it is negotiable, then we close this right ventricular outflow tract by putting a patch only in the right ventricular outflow. But if adequate size of the Haggart's cannot be negotiated, then we have to open the main pulmonary artery through a vertical incision. And if there is a commissural fusion only, then we have to do the commissurotomy. And balloon pulmonary valvuloplasty can be done through this right ventricular outflow tract. And we have done few cases with a good results. And after pulmonary valve commissurotomy, once the adequate size Haggart's can be negotiated, they have to close the main pulmonary artery and the right ventricular outflow tract by putting separate pericardial patch. But if the annulus is very small and the valve is dysplastic, then we may have to do the pulmonary valvectomy. We have to go across the annulus, and then after excision of the valve, we have to put a transannular patch of pericardium. And it's better to put a competent valve before putting the transannular patch. Otherwise, there will be free flow PR, and which will have a late right ventricular dysfunction. That's why actually worldwide, all the pediatric cardiac surgeons are trying to make a competent right ventricular outflow tract. And also in National Heart Foundation, we are, for last decades, we are trying to develop how to make a competent pulmonary valve. Initially, before say around 2008-09, we used to put only the competent valve, but it gives free flow PR. Then we started putting a monocusp, which gives initially the good results. Initial competency is good, and early postoperative outcome is also good. But lately, they develop pulmonary regurgitation and also a very lately pulmonary stenosis. And then we started putting the PTFE bileaflet valve by Graham Nunn techniques. It gives very good results. It's a very competent valve with minimal pulmonary regurgitation. This valve is made by 0.1 millimeter thick PTFE patch. It gives a very good competent valve, but the problem is that we cannot put it in a very small children, because otherwise they develop early pulmonary stenosis. This is the only disadvantage of this valve. And also few patients develop pulmonary regurgitation after few years. So nowadays we changed our protocol, and from the last year we started putting a quintessential valves, and it can be, it's a very easy to make and it's very reproducible. You have to take a PTFE 0.1 millimeter PTFE patch, fold it, and then make a hole in the center, and the there will be two limb. One limb we have to, after closing the VSD, one limb we have to anastomose with the right ventricular outflow tract at the interventricular septal level, and the upper limb we have to anastomose with the free margin of the right ventricular outflow tract. This is the after the anastomosis of the lower limb and negotiating the Haggers through the opening. And after anastomosing the upper leaf with the right free margin of the right ventricular outflow tract, then we have to put the transannular patch of pericardium as usually. Again, the disadvantage of this is we cannot put it in a very small children. Now we are putting it around 5 years of age, and if the child is very small, even monocusp is not very good, but we don't have other option. We have to put the monocusp if we want to make a competent valve, at least for the time being. After this is the main component of the operation, and after completion of the operation, we routinely measure the right ventricular and left ventricular pressure, and lower one is the right ventricular pressure. This is the less than 50% of the systemic pressure. Awesome. this lower one is the pulmonary artery pressure. See, the diastolic pressure is very good, 19 millimeter. It means this, the pulmonary valve is very much competent. Now, if the patient is having very large MAPCAS, how to manage? We can manage MAPCA preoperatively during operation or even postoperatively. Preoperatively, if the MAPCA is very large, like this one, there are huge MAPCAS, then better to handle it preoperatively by doing coil embolization. Otherwise, there will be huge flooding of the operating field, so it will be very difficult to continue the operation, and definitely it will give trouble in the postoperative period. This is after coil embolization, and if the patient is very much cyanotic, we cannot go for coil embolization very early. We have to do the coil embolization in the day of surgery, the cath lab, we have to do the coil embolization and then transfer the patient in the operation theater and do the complete the operation. Otherwise, the patient may crash if it is MAPCA dependent circulation or the patient is very cyanotic. If the MAPCA is not that huge and it is approachable, we can ligate or clip the MAPCAs during operation. And if we miss the MAPCAs during operation and it gives troubles in the postoperative period, particularly after weaning, if there is a huge MAPCA flow, some patients gives troubles, that is, they may develop acute LVF and for the pulmonary edema. In that case, we have to take the patient in the cath lab and have to do the coil embolization in the cath lab. Now, the another subset of the tetralogy is the tetralogy fellow with the pulmonary atresia. And normally, in tetralogy fellow, there is an integrate flow through the pulmonary artery. But in tetralogy fellow, there is no integrate flow. It may be valvular atresia or it unmuted, may be blind. So the pulmonary circulation is dependent on the PDA or MAPCAS. Or depending on the anatomy, have to take the make the strategy for MAPCA is confluent. If the pulmonary artery is confluent and there is a favorable pulmonary artery anatomy, can do single stage repair at a suitable age, and the component of the repair is the VSD closure and RV to uniformize MAPCA's connection directly or through the conduit. If the pulmonary arteries are hypoplastic, then we have to do the shunt initially and then go for the RV to PA connection either directly or through a conduit once the pulmonary artery grows. Or initially we can put a palliative RV to pulmonary artery connection, and then once the PA grows, then we can go for total correction. And if the pulmonary artery is non-confluent with the MAPCAS, then we may have to reconstruct the pulmonary arteries and unifocalize and then RV to PA conduit according to the situation of the patient. Another subset is the TOF with absent pulmonary valve. In absent pulmonary valve, there's an incompletely formed rudimentary pulmonary valve, and both the stem is there, and on auscultation there will be harsh through and fro murmur, and there is usually huge posterior stenotic dilatation of the pulmonary artery. And huge posterior stenotic dilatation of the pulmonary arteries may compress the airway and it may cause the airway obstruction. There may be air trapping, only air can go into the lungs, but it cannot come out. In this case, there will be affected lung will be hyperinflated, and it may give tremendous trouble in the post-operative period. And there may also be develop bronchomalacia due to compression of the bronchus, dilated pulmonary arteries. This is the CT angiogram of the TOF with absent pulmonary artery, hugely dilated MPA and RPA and LPA. Surgical treatment is as usual, that is, you have to close the VSD, you have to resect the pulmonary artery. In addition to this usual procedure, we have to do the pulmonary artery reduction blasty. If there is any compression effect, then we have, may have to go do the Leconte procedure. Then we have to put the pulmonary artery in front of the aorta. This is the all about the corrective treatment and palliative treatment of the tetralogy of Fallot. Now I will highlight the postoperative complications. In early period, there may be increased bleeding. As we know, there is a platelet dysfunction in tetralogy of Fallot. There is a chance of increased bleeding in the postoperative period. So the surgeon should be very careful about the plus opening and closing of the chest. And there is, as we have to cut, resect the muscle bands, particularly if we have to resect the septal band, there is an increased chance of arrhythmia in the postoperative period. And the junctional ectopic tachycardia is more common in tetralogy of Fallot repair patient. And there is also chance of the development of the RV dysfunction in the early postoperative period. And some surgeons ignore the LV part, but there is also chance of the LV dysfunction because of the hypoxia. Both the RV and LV may be become non-compliant. And there is a chance of LV dysfunction in addition to RV dysfunction also. That's why my trainer Rajesh Sharma usually always put the LA catheter in all tetralogy of the patient to assess the postoperative LV dysfunction and manage it accordingly. And ultimately, LV and LV dysfunction may lead to the low cardiac output syndrome. Among the late complications, there may be residual pulmonary stenosis. To avoid this late complications, we have to resect the alveolar muscle band. And to do tracheotomy or pulmonary valvectomy as whatever it is needed to avoid these complications. As I have already mentioned, there is a, if we have to put the transannular patch, there is obviously there will be pulmonary regurgitation. So to avoid this pulmonary regurgitation, we have to have competent valve, right ventricular outflow tract. And if there is a pulmonary regurgitation and there will be progressive dilatation of the right ventricle and there will be like right ventricular dysfunction. And this right ventricular dysfunction may lead to tachyarrhythmias, and intractable ventricular tachyarrhythmia may cause sudden death even. And another complication is the aortic regurgitation. Actually, in tetralogy of Fallot patient, lots of patients are there who have aortopathy from the very beginning of their life. And this aorta progressively gets enlarged and may develop significant aortic regurgitation. We may have to fix later on. And some few years, and as we have to put the synthetic material, particularly for reconstruction of the right ventricular outflow tract, and we have to put the synthetic patch in the, for closing the VSD, there is obviously chance of infected endocarditis. To avoid this, we prophylactic put prophylactic antibiotic
or at least for 6 months after operation. So in summary, the surgical EPR is the only definitive treatment of the tetralogy of Fallot, and early total correction is always better, and we need staged EPR in selective cases, and we need reoperation in some cases, and meticulous primary repair with preservation or reconstruction of the pulmonary valve reduces or delay the need for reoperation. Finally, it's a very remunerating surgery, and patient also gets happy, parents also gets happy, and surgeons also become very happy after seeing this type of pink baby who was very much cyanosed, ugly looking, and so thank you all from the team pediatric cardiac surgical team of National Heart Foundation Hospital. Thank you for patient sharing.
Thank you, Dr. A.K. Shamsuddin sir, for your excellent lecture. Now is the time for question answer session. There is actually, ma'am, there is no question in the chat box.
I want to ask a question now.
Yes. Can
is
I ask?
Is there any need in few cases for the single ventricle type of repair? We know that in tetralogy of Fallot, total corrective surgery is required. Possible in most of the cases, but in some cases we have seen that LV is very small or RV is too much hypertrophied, and in late presentation cases RV is too much hypertrophied and there is chance of RV failure after doing any surgery on the right side of the heart. So do you think that in some cases single ventricle repair is better than that of the right biventricular repair?
Right, madam. In very few cases, we may get very hypertrophied RV and very small RV cavity. In that cases, rather than I'll say, instead of doing single ventricle repair, we can go for one and half ventricle repair. We can, if we open the right ventricular outflow tract, there will always be a chance of growing the right ventricle. So we can take that chance. So that is, I think, it's a relatively better option that instead of going for single ventricle repair.
Especially in late presentation cases, like 8 years old, like we have some cases even 30, 40 years old. Very late presentation.
Obviously, it will be the last resort. If it is, if even one and a half ventricle repair is not also possible, then we have to go for single ventricle repair. If the RV is unipartite, only one part is there, other part is not there, and tricuspid valve is very small, then we have to go for single ventricle repair. But if it is not that much very late, then we can take chance by doing one and a half ventricle repair.
Yeah.
Thank you, Doctor.
There is a question in the chat box. Should I read, madam?
Yes, yes.
This is a question from Dr. Abdul Jabbar. What are the surgical considerations when there is RVOT crossing LAD? Additional cost for attendance. What are the surgical considerations when there is RVOT crossing LAD?
Answer.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Actually, we have to. That's why we have to look for the coronary artery before operation. If the pulmonary annulus is small and we have to put a transannular patch, then there are few options. The double barrel repair. We can cut the muscle bands. Right ventricular outflow tract, and we can put a RV2PA conduit, either valved or non-valved conduit. That is the double barrel repair.
or if the patient is pulmonary annulus is adequate, then may not to worry, because we don't have to cut the pulmonary annulus. We can manage below the coronary artery. After excising the muscle, you can put just the annuity patch. And if the LAD is a little low, and we can also sometimes manage by doing a limited pulmonary wall.
Okay, Dr. Shamsuddin, I have one very important question to you. You know that pediatric cardiologists are the people who refer the patient to you for surgery. And you need many actually surgical questions from the surgical perspective. You know many questions to be answered from the echocardiography or even from the CT angiography. So what is your expectation to a pediatric cardiologist or a radiologist about the findings you want to know from them before deciding your surgical plan? So what things you want specifically from a pediatric cardiologist, so that our students, they will be able to know that what are the things they should record in their echocardiography or in the CT angiography report?
Actually, madam, I mentioned already that a good pediatric cardiologist can give all the information what surgeons need by doing echocardiography. Most of the information we need, that is the VSD, VSD is size, VSD numbers, and the overriding of degree of overriding of the aorta, LV and RV adequacy. Whether the what you already have mentioned, that sometimes RV may not be adequate, LV and RV adequacy. And LV adequacy also, we have to assess the mitral and tricuspid wall ratio and the pulmonary artery size, whether it is adequate to take the total correction or not, and the pulmonary artery valve annulus, and the whether the coronary is crossing the right ventricular outflow tract or not, and the whether there is any MAP cast, proximal MAP cast can be seen even in echocardiography. But in addition to that, sometimes the MAP cast which arises from the descending aorta can be missed by echocardiography. In CT angiogram, it can be well delineated. And even in CT angiogram, some MAP cast looks very big, but they don't supply is a huge territory. And in the other way, some MAP casts are small, but they supply huge territory, which cannot be delineated in CT angiogram. In that case, if we can go for cardiac care, it can delineate the very well the area of supply of the MAP cast. And whether it is a single supply or dual supply, or the whether it is supplying the huge territory or not. So this much of information, minimum information we need. And as in our center, we work together, the pediatric cardiologist and cardiac surgeons. We surgeon always used to see the echo by ourselves with the pediatric cardiologist on the day before operation. If there is any query, we just recheck the echo, and our cardiologist satisfy our queries. Thank you, madam.
Do you use transesophageal echocardiography during surgery in these cases?
No, madam. We don't use routinely transesophageal
echo. So you don't need any support of the transesophageal during surgery?
Obviously, it is better. If there is any additional lesion, that is the aortic regurgitation or tricuspid regurgitation or mitral regurgitation, we have to assess after operation, then we put the transesophageal echo. But obviously it's better either transesophageal echo or epicardial echo after any corrective surgery.
Yeah, what about suppose a patient is now 2 years old, but still having hypoplastic pulmonary artery, Meggen ratio is less. So in this case, what will be your option? You will go for the shunt, or you will go for the RBOT stenting, or you will go for the palliative transannular patch? which one will be better for this age, like 2 years, still hypoplastic pulmonary arteries, my gun is less, Nakata index is less, what should you will do in these cases?
I will take either of the shunt, systemic to pulmonary artery shunt, or palliative transannular patch. If the both pulmonary arteries is small, then transannular patch, then there will be a good chance of developing the both the pulmonary arteries equally. And if the one pulmonary artery is small, either left or right, we can do the modified BT shunt in either side of the patient. And we don't know actually, actually in a very small children, growth potential is very high, so far I understand. So it may take time to grow the pulmonary arteries. So I will not prefer to tell the cardiologist to put the RVOT scan, because long-term RVOT scan, if it get fibrosed and it may get very difficult for the surgeon to take out the RVOT scan in future. But if it is for a very temporary period of time, if it is a very dynamic RVOT obstruction, repeated spell attack, then for rescue purpose, can put the RVOT scan.
I don't know why students are not asking question today. This is such a interesting subject.
May I ask a question now?
Yes, please.
This is Dr. Sirin. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Shamsuddin, for your excellent presentation. And you have covered almost everything in the management of tetralogy of Fallot from the surgical point of view. Yes, my question that is, you are using the bicuspid pulmonary reconstruction and modified monocost reconstruction as well, both. But for the bicuspid reconstruction, what kind of patch you are using, 0.4 or 0.1?
Thank you, Dr. Sarim. We are using a 0.1 millimeter PTFE patch.
For both modified monocoque and for both. Okay. So do you think the 0.1 patch, if we use for the bicuspid deconstruction, and its orientation is not like that is it falls on the posterior wall of pulmonary artery, it is a vertical position, unlike the modified monocost reconstruction in case of bicuspid. So this modified one, during systole, the blood will go up, and during diastole, it will come down and it will close and it will not allow the blood to go down to the right ventricle. And in the original literature, they have used 0.4, which is stiff and it can maintain the vertical shape of the modified cast, that is the newly formed valve. But if you use the 0.1 cast, 0.1 membrane, then it cannot maintain the vertical shape of the valve. So what is your opinion? Because in the original literature, they have used 0.4.
Yeah, I got your point, sir. In our institute, Professor Sharifuzzaman used a few cases, 0.4 millimeter, particularly the relatively older patients. The problem is that in 0.4 millimeter, and the movement become restricted, and we got some patients with a non-functional valve after a few months, 2 years. So I'm not comfortable with using the 0.4 millimeter patch. And nowadays, as I already mentioned, we are using quintessenza valve. This is the latest modification, and we are using it, and we are getting very good results. And there is no chance of the falling of the cusp, because one cusp is attached with the septal part of the RVOT and another is the free margin. So its closing and opening is excellent and gives tremendous good results. And we are getting, almost no pulmonary degradation after operation.
Yeah, and what is your experience in the patients where the pulmonary casts are not reconstructed, free pulmonary degradation? What is your experience?
Some patients give troubles in the postoperative period. They take longer period of the ICU stay needs more inotropic support. Some patients may go to the low output syndrome, particularly if the patient also had some degree of TR in addition to free flow PR. These patients sometimes behave badly in the postoperative period. Almost all the cases we sail through, but it takes longer period of time to recover.
Actually, your the bicuspid deconstruction technique, I'll request you to send the picture again so that I can see how you're doing with point one, because bicuspid deconstruction in every center they are using 0.4, and modified monocast and monocast they are, that I learned from National Heart Foundation, Shadfuzaman, those are using the 0.1 mm cast. Just I'll request you to send the pictures, please, in future.
Obviously, I will send you the paper.
Thank you. That will be a kindness.
No problem.
I want to learn that.
You can reproduce easily, no problem.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah, someone raised hand. Can you check?
Yes, ma'am. It was Muhammad Rukunuzzaman Salim.
Okay.
There is a question, ma'am. Another question is from Dr. Ashfaq. It's the ideal age practiced for total correction at your center.
Dr. Ashfaq, nice to see you. We in National Heart Foundation, I already mentioned they around 6 months onward. We do the total correction. If the patient is very much symptomatic, we do less than 1 year, that is 6 months to 1 year. And if it is not that much symptomatic, then 1 year onwards, we do the total correction.
I just want to ask another question on behalf of our student. You know, there are so many complications which may arise in the postoperative period. I just want to ask you about one, which is like if you miss some additional BSD in the lower part of the muscular septum, or if there is a residual BSD, what kind of problem you face in the postoperative period, especially in immediate postoperative period?
If it is a very small, then there is not much problem. But if it is a big, then it gives problem, particularly while weaning from the mechanical ventilation. We faced one or two cases, and we have taken the patient to the OR and fixed the VSD, and then we are able to wean from the mechanical ventilation. Usually, the patient develop pulmonary edema while starting the weaning trial. The patient have pink for the. Faces one or two patients, and after fixing the problem, we could able to manage that patients.
Yeah, because there is too much left to right shunt, because so long pulmonary circulation was protected by PS, and when you relieve that, there is too much flow from the BSD to the pulmonary circulation, and there is, as you mentioned, there is pulmonary edema and there is heart failure. So this is actually one of the bad complications which may happen.
Yes,
so,
ma'am.
Is there any question, Dr. Salam, if you want to ask any question?
Thank you, ma'am, for giving me the chance. Actually, I'm really amazed to see Shamsuddin in a very good shape after the COVID infection. Thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has been cured very quickly. Today's delivery, he has given very nicely in a comprehensive, concise, and very nice way. I learned many things from his delivery. And actually, tetralogia fallot is a common disease in our practice. And surgical treatment is the main option of treatment, except in few cases of RVOT stenting or PDA stenting for just for palliation. So to learn from the surgeon, it is very quite interesting, and we learned very much informative things from Shamsuddin. He has cleared all the issues, particularly how he made this bicuspid valve, actually recent modification, I want to say, that is the approach to total correction of tautology of failure starts from 6 months, and in some center below 6 months, if there is no hypoplastic pulmonary artery, usually they used to go for total correction to avoid those complications related to this hypoxia and other things which Shamsuddin has nicely managed mentioned. And the process has been changed drastically because in earlier period it was known that once you have done an intracardiac repair of tautology of failure, the problem is over. But after a few years, last few years, we could understand, the whole world can understand that there is a lot of late complication or late sequelae, particularly RV dysfunction. So you may need have some re-intervention or re-surgery. So that is saving the pulmonary valve is the main option or target for the surgeon. After repairing the RVOT, the preservation of pulmonary valve anatomy is the most important thing that can save, that can prevent the future re-intervention or re-surgery. So these are the few things I can mention. And other things have been already here. So I really enjoyed, I thanks from core of my heart, Dr. Shamsuddin, for giving this such a nice deliberation. Thank you very much.
There are three questions in the chat box. Yes. From Mohammad Sahariya Kami. Is there any role of stenting of PDA to keep PDA open in hypoplastic PA? PDA stenting, role of any?
Obviously there is a role. It acts as a beatician. If the patient is very sick and cannot go for, patient is having repeated spell attack and cannot go for total correction immediately, then instead of doing the BT shunt, can go for the PDA stenting also.
Another question is, what is the, this is from Dr. Aziz Al-Maksud. What is the approximate cost for both palliative and total correction at your center?
For palliative surgery, if it is a BT shunt, then 5,000 package and plus cost of the shunt, that is 20,000. And if it is a total correction, it is basic package is 1,85,000.
And what are the most common complications you face? And what is the rate of infection during post-op period?
Infection rate of patients may have to stay longer period in the ICU. And as you know, as if the patient stays very long period in the ICU, then there is obviously chance of infection will also high proportionately, but it's reasonable in our institute.
Shamsuddin, I have a little question to you, because in Bangladesh, actually, I think your center has done the maximum tautology of failure repair. So those cases are returning with complication like that of NOIC class heart failure 3 or like this, or like 2. With RV dysfunction, what is your approach and how you are getting and how you manage these cases? Do you prefer to go for PPVI or go for surgical valve implantation?
Thank you, sir, for your very good question. Actually, as we are doing much total correction, we'll face this in future. Actually, already we started facing this problem. So till now, actually, we have not done for RV dysfunction, we have not operated yet till now. But there are few patients online, one or two patients who will require some sorts of treatment because of the RV dysfunction. We are watching these patients. We are keeping them in follow-up. So if the RV dysfunction, they are having some form of RV dysfunction. If it increases, and then we may have to go for pulmonary valve replacement or reconstruction.
Shamsuddin, I have a question. That is, you told that your package is 1,85,000 for tetralogy fellow. How about the cost of patches? That is for VHD closure 0.4 patch, for RVD reconstruction 0.1 membrane. Those costs are included or those are separate?
I said this is the basic package, 1,80,000. If we have to use the patch, then the cost of the patch is extra. It is approximately around 40,000 we charge for one patient.
For valve reconstruction, how much do you charge from the patient? If they need valve reconstruction?
No extra charge, only cost of the patch.
There is a patch, how much they cost?
On an average.
On an average, 40,000. Okay.
He said,
I told around 40,000.
Another question, Jakia.
Yes, ma'am. Another question. It's from Dr. Aziz Al Maksud. Generally, for how many years a post op tough repaired patient need to be followed?
Actually, ideally, it should be lifelong.
Lifelong.
Yes.
Another question is ideal time of total correction after MVT shunt.
Ideal, it depends on whether the pulmonary artery grows adequately or not. It may be 6 months to 1 year, or even may take more than 1 year. And we, after putting the shunt, we used to follow the patient. First 1 month, 3 months, six, and then 6 months interval. Once the PA grow adequately, then we do the total correction.
Okay, next question is from Mohammad Shahriar Kabir. The criteria of good outcome of total correction in adult. Total correction in adult.
Total correction in adult actually itself is not an ideal situation. Tough should be corrected very early. Even then, yes. Some patients come to us with the in a late stage. We do the total correction and.
I have some queries. We recently are getting some patient about 13, 14 years of old patient with hypoplastic PA, severely cyanosed, and hematocrit is raised, and also RV dysfunction. What is the outcome of this type of patient?
This type actually very difficult because the outcome is not good. So. Because of the very, very much hypoxic and thick cyanotic patients, these patients may have LV dysfunction, may have RV dysfunction, and gives tremendous troubles in the post-operative period. If we have to do it, if there is not much dysfunction before operation, we can do the phlebotomy. We can wait for some time. One or two cases I have done, around 12 to 13 years, One patient was having LV dysfunction. Ejection fraction was around 40 to 45%. So I have not operated. I did the phlebotomy, wait for a few months. Then surprisingly, we have seen that his LV function improves. Then we went for total correction and the patient did well. So we have to optimize the patient and then go for total correction.
Dr. Zakia,
yes, sir.
Actually, make a comments on the particular fellows. They, after our total correction of tetralogy of fellow,
if there is no more question, Jakia, we can. I just want to say something in conclusion, and then we'll conclude.
Yes.
So, about tetralogy of fellow, I just want to mention few important things. Tetralogy of fellow is a disease which may present at birth. So, spectrum of disease varies from neonatal period to untreated ACHD, adult congenital heart disease. So a patient may be a newborn, a patient may be a 60 years old. So there is a wide spectrum before doing surgery. So there is a problem of before surgery cases and problem of after surgery cases. Now, before surgery cases, if there is a severe form of tetralogy of Fallot, even in the newborn period, they have severe cyanosis and you have to do something for them even in the neonatal period. So what to do at that time? If there is a PDA, best thing is to go for the stenting. If there is no PDA, best thing is to go for BT shunt, because in neonatal period, it is not possible to go for the total repair. And then problem may arise like in early infancy, in up to 6 months of age. So in up to 6 months of age, still we have some patient, there is no PDA, so there is no chance of PDA stenting. These babies, they are frequently spelling. Every day they need some kind of management for the spell, remain admitted in the ICU for a long time. For these cases, we go for the RBOT stenting, because surgery is more high risk in this period and no one wants to take this patient who are spelling, who are not gaining weight. I can remember one of our patients who was 7 months old, only 3 kg weight, and was ICU bound for all these 6 months. And then no one was accepting the patient for BT shunt even, because patient was very sick, not gaining any weight. And we failed to refer the patient to the neighboring country because she was not fit for actually travel. So one day while she was spilling and she was almost dying, I took that girl to the cath lab and I did the RBOT stand. This was in 2006 or 7. And immediately after doing the stand, the child, she changed totally. And from the next day, she started playing. And then she learned how to sit. And after 3 months, her body weight was, she was 3 kg. And then after 3 months, she was like 7-8 kg. And then we referred her to our escort health heart institute, where she was operated for the total correction. So this is like something emergency management. So tetralogy of fellow patients, they sometimes need emergency management for the spell. If you cannot control the spell, you may go up to the even BT shunt, even stenting, even RBOT stenting, even PD stenting. So you may have emergency situation in tetralogy of fellow in neonatal period, in infancy period. And then sometimes this kind of patient, they actually know how to manage their spell by themselves. So they learn what to do when there is a spell. So they take their squatting position by themselves. And when they grow older, their spell reduces in frequency because they know how to manage themselves. So these are the problems in the infancy period. And as Dr. Shamsuddin has mentioned that early surgery, we know that in USA, in UK, they do this kind of surgery in very early stage because your right ventricle is always under pressure. Right ventricle has to pump the blood to the pulmonary circulation against so much pressure resistance. So this RV, if you can operate in early stage, it is better for the RV for the future life, because too much over RV, even if there is no problem immediately in postoperative period, there may be RV failure later on because of the too much overwork of the pre-surgery time. So these are one group of the patient. And now ACHD group, those who are with adult congenital heart disease with untreated cases, they have some problem like severe RBH. Some of them might have small pulmonary arteries. Some of them have large MAPCAS, which may cause even pulmonary hypertension in some of the cases. So their problem is different. And I have seen in my experience in our hospital, there are many cases like 40 years, 50 years. Many of them, they have 1.5 ventricle repair. Many of them have single ventricle repair. And then if possible, surgery is possible if all the criteria are fulfilled, if RB and LBs are good, if pulmonary arteries are good. So even total correction is possible in that age group. Now, what is important is tetralogy of Fallot is the commonest cyanotic congenital heart disease. we are doing surgeries. I am working with the pediatric cardiology since 1998. So it is now like 23 years. And I have referred so many cases in early part of my profession. And these patients are now like 18 years old, like 20 years old. And now we are facing the problems of the post-operative complications of the PR. At that time, you know that this monoleaflet and the bileaflet, these valves were not used. And there was free PR, there was transannular patch. My consultant in Saudi Arabia, he used to tell me every time that transannular patch is a malignant disease and you will see the problems after surgery. So transannular patch is a malignancy because it will give you PR. And this PR in course of time will give you RV volume overload. In course of time, there will be RV failure. And not only RV failure, there will be many kind of tachyarrhythmia and there will be sudden cardiac death. So usually when I see this kind of patient, I always give them some kind of beta blocker to prevent sudden cardiac death or to prevent tachyarrhythmia in sleeping time or in some when the patient do not notice this even when they are in sleep. So these kind of problems now we are getting, and we did many cases of melody valve already. Most of them were trough repair cases. Some of them were like TGA, BHD, PS, some of them were truncus repair, but most of them were tetralogy of Fallot repair cases. Now, percutaneous pulmonary valve implantation is a very costly procedure. It is not possible for average income people of our country. You need 30 to 35 lakh taka, but surgical pulmonary valve implantation is easy. Is not easy, but it is less expensive. I have like 10 to 15 cases who have already pulmonary valve implantation by surgical technique. They're doing very well after their surgery. I have few cases in follow-up who are having like RVOT aneurysm. They have severely dilated RVOT. So in these cases, plication, reduction plasty is required. So for the tetralogy of Fallot cases, though there is surgery available, though there are many palliative treatment available, but still they have chance of some complications, and surgeons are working on that, how to reduce that complication. So they have innovated this valve technique to put in the pulmonary valve. And nowadays, so I am seeing this kind of patient for long, 23 years. And now what I am seeing is that there is very little PR. And when I do the post-operative echo, I feel very happy when I see only very minimal PR or there is mild PR. Actually, I am afraid of PR in post-operative cases of the tetralogy of Fallot. So in my post-operative echoes, I always want to see minimum PR. And I will request our surgeon, you are doing fine, you are doing great job. And from now onward, I think there will be no complications regarding this pulmonary regurgitation. There will be no complication regarding RV dysfunction because PR is the main thing, which is followed by tricuspid regurgitation. And later there is tricuspid regurgitation also when RV enlarged and there is enlargement of the tricuspid valve annulus. So main problem is the PR. And if we can deal with the PR during the surgery time, there will be no more requirement for the pulmonary valve implantation either by surgical technique or by the percutaneous technique in future. But so far, in whole world, there are so many tetralogy of repair cases moving around with free PR with valvotomy. So for next 15, 20 years, we'll work with those. But I think after 20 years, we will get rid from this kind of complication. Thank you, Dr. Shamsuddin. You were sick. And even then, you have attended Tuesday's session. Today's session was
actually... There is another question. Should I read, madam?
Yes, yes.
What are the predictors of RV dysfunction to be tackled immediate post-op period?
Who asked this question?
Dr. Ashfaq.
Okay.
Okay, can I answer?
Yes.
If the RV is very much hypertrophied and both the septal and parietal bands are very hypertrophied and if during operation we have to excise the septal bands, then there is a always chance of RV dysfunction in the postoperative period. That's why I used to prefer to cut as minimum as possible in the septal bands. If we cut more septal bands, there is a more chance of right ventricular dysfunction. But it's not always possible to avoid the cutting of the septal bands. So we have to make a check and balance. We have to keep the RVOT pattern, as well as we have to cut at as less as possible, the particularly the septal bands. So there will be less RV dysfunction in the postoperative period. Thank you.
I think, Jackia, you can close now.
Yes, ma'am.
Any more question if you have?
No more question, ma'am. Okay. I want to conclude the session. Dear participants, we are now at the end of the session, and thank you all for active participation and patient sharing. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Shamsuddin. I think you are fine now. Apni ki shustho?
Alhamdulillah, madam.